Good morning and welcome to the Pastor's Corner. I'm Pastor Wayne Baker, bringing you the Pastor's Corner. We believe to be the inspired word of God. We're going to start where we took off last week in Philippians, the first chapter, and in verse 21. Boy, what a word this morning. But first of all, let us have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I do appreciate your word. I appreciate your people. I appreciate those who support this ministry. And Lord, save them from this pandemic. I pray that for our government, that everything will be all right. And Lord, I pray for the members of this church. I pray for those who have caught coronavirus. Bless them, help them, and Lord, heal them. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Now, the theme of our message this morning is joy in suffering. You see, there's a joy in suffering. The Bible says, by much trials and temptations, we enter into the kingdom of God. Sometimes us Christians think that every day will be rosy red and sugar sweet. Where did you get that from? The Bible does not support that. The Bible does not support prosperity for Christians. Many of you, I had a man here who came and said he was going to get his $1 million. He's joining another church, by the way. Joined one of these prosperity churches. Well, at a funeral, I saw him, and I don't think he's a millionaire yet. The prosperity gospel is the greatest tool that Satan has in our churches, along with white supremacy or white racism. Those are the greatest enemies to the church today. Let me throw in the third one. Politics in the church is killing the church, folks. It's killing the church. And so Paul never told anybody that they would get $1 million if they worship. He never told anybody when they put something in the offering plate that multiplied by 100 or tenfold. That's modern preacher garbage, for the lack of a better word. If you are a true servant of Jesus Christ, you may have to suffer. Suffer if you got an unchristian husband. Suffer if you got an unchristian wife. Suffer if you got an unchristian boss. Suffer in this world around ungodly people. That's the gospel, my friend. But the thing is, your challenge with this: will you give up or live up to your Christian faith, or will you let it go? Will you use it as a spare tire? When you get around your friends and buddies, you put it back, take it off? Or do you wear it all the time? Are you the same every day? Well, Paul said this: for me to live is Christ. Paul didn't say, if I got a new car, if I got a new house, if I got a new horse, if I got new boots. He didn't say that, did he? Paul said, I'm going to live this Christian life, whether in life or in death. I'm going to live for Christ. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. People, where have you heard this from except in the Bible? You know, people get up and testify all the time. And I would like to hear some people speak the words of St. Paul, as he did in 2 Corinthians. Paul said, I will glory in my infirmities, that the power of God might rest on me. People, those are powerful words. Glory in your infirmity. And then Paul said again in Philippians, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, being made conformable unto his death. Yes, God, the God of this universe, will bless you. But I want you to know, he is under no obligation. God cannot help but bless a person who obeys his commandments. Well, you got, what is a blessing? A blessing is keeping your children out of jail. Blessing is raising a good family. Blessing is working on a job. Blessing is having the joy of God. Paul said to live is Christ and to die is gain. Wow, that's a two-fold winning situation. Live for Christ, you win, and die, you gain. And this is repeated sometime at every funeral. Paul goes on further, verse 22 of chapter 1. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. In other words, if you're living in the flesh, you're being rewarded by the fruits of your labor. Yet what I shall choose, I would not. For I am in a strait betwixt two. Now this is a man who had gotten a glimpse of heaven, you see. He had seen heaven. And God said, Paul, I'm not going to do it. You've already seen more than most men. Paul was caught up to the third heaven in 2 Corinthians. So God said, I'm going to give you something better than healing. He had asked God three times to heal his infirmity. God said, I'm going to give you my grace because my grace is sufficient for you. And so Paul said, to be with Christ, he was in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. But then he realized something. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. He realized, see, you got a twofold duty on this earth. I have one myself. First, to preach to my congregation, to disciple people, to feed the babies, to help older babes in Christ, to mature the saints. You see, and Paul knew he had that responsibility. So he said, Lord, it's in your hand, but I'm ready to die. I'll be glad if you get me out of this because I'm suffering. But Paul said, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. Now, goodness gracious, that is the way I believe that everybody should come to the end. Lord, if you want me to stay here, I'll stay here. If you want me to go, I'm ready to go. It's far better to be with you. Now, look at the confidence of Paul. Paul was confident. He was confident in this very thing that God, who had begun a good work in him, will perform until the day of Christ. And God did. And having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. That was to the church. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel. You see, conversation means lifestyle. When you carry our conversation is in heaven, that means our lifestyle is in heaven. And also, I'm going to make an application in the physical. A conversation is what you talk about, but it has more to do with a lifestyle than anything else. Let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. People, there are people in church who talks about anything. Some people will run folk away from the church with their mouth. I'm very serious about this. Telling folks anything about the man of God, talking about each other, the deacons and what have you. People, we ought to be more mature in a body than that. When I worked at my former employee, they told me, one thing you don't do, you don't talk about people and you don't discuss Harry. And I never did the entire time I was there. But why? Because it causes conflict on the job and at the office. And you cannot get your product out with a whole lot of conflict. Therefore, whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind striving together for the faith. Now, three things Paul said. You stand fast in one spirit. The church cannot tolerate all kinds of spirit. You cannot tolerate Mohammedanism, Christianity, Judaism, and all these other religions. You need to be of the same mind. You need to know the same thing about Jesus Christ. You need to export the same thing about Jesus Christ. You need to be of the same mind in the Lord with each other in Christ. And you're striving together for the faith of the gospel. All of these things in the Christian church. If we do that, people, there would be no room for arguing. There would be no room for bucking the pastor. There would be no room for rebellion against God. But you will be all of the same mind. Now, Paul reminds them again in verse 29, chapter 1, verse 29. And in nothing terrified by your adversary. One of the reasons, evidence of the Holy Ghost in Acts, I've studied it, was not tongues. It was boldness. When people were filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized with the Holy Ghost, they were bold. And this boldness made them stand up against the Herods, made them stand up against the Pilates, the Sanhedrin court, all of these people. God moved these people out of the way. And it prompted Peter to say, man should obey God, not man. In other words, Paul was lifted from the prison by an angel. How Paul got out, no one knows. But the angel of the Lord, and when he was at the place where they were praying, they thought Paul was a ghost. God will deliver you. God will help you. God will protect you. But one of the manifestations of the Holy Ghost is boldness. Now, you got a lot of people who are into this tongue thing. I wish the church would grow up and see what tongues were about and why they were originally given. Everybody heard one another in their own language. So that meant everybody could hear the same thing, and then they could propagate the gospel, carry the gospel out in their tongues. Why then is tongues necessary? You know, if a person come speaking to me with tongues, I don't know what they're saying, you see. And some people can speak Chinese, that's a tongue. Some people can speak the very African language. People don't be carried away by tongues. These are baby things, as it explained in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Baby things. Paul said, I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, I am nothing. Then he said later on, when that which is perfect is come. And love is a perfect state that we ought to be in at all time. Love one another, help one another, pray for one another, be of the same mind toward one another. And in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them evident token of perdition. In other words, Paul said, if you show fear and what have you, if you're not bold in front of your enemies and adversaries, it shows that you are in a state of perdition, which is of the devil, if that word is used. But to you of salvation and that of God. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. You see, suffering. This is the theme of the New Testament. Excuse me. This is a theme of the Bible. Suffering. Will you suffer for the Lord Jesus Christ? Now we go to chapter 2. The theme of chapter 2 is joy in serving. So, see, you can serve out of fear, you can serve for pay, but do you get joy out of serving? joy out of serving. This is the theme of chapter 2. You got to be humble like Christ was humble. And we'll see as this chapter progresses the humility of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came from heaven. He came from God. He came from the bosom of God. And he was humbled. The Bible says he emptied himself. Well, let's go and see verse by verse. You got to be humble like Christ. Verse 1, chapter 2. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies. Now just look at the colorful language that the great apostle uses. If there's any fellowship in the Spirit, if there's any comfort of love, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, one mind. Now, this is also a thing that happens in the Christian church. Sometimes we exalt other people and put some people down, and we're not of the same mind. I remember I pastored a church, and they really didn't want young folks in there. They didn't want welfare folks in there. And so I was young, I was kind of a fool, you see. Bishop told me to go and clean up, and that's what I did. And I remember they didn't want the young folks up in the sanctuary, just an old antiquated Methodist church. That's all I can say. It's an old antiquated First Methodist church. I went to the welfare area. I went down and preached. I set up a little tent there, preached. And they started joining the church. The church started filling up. You know what? Somebody came and told me, "Rum Baker, we don't want folks like that in our church." I remember there was a person, his name was John. John had to make a path through his house, because there were so many beer bottles and wine bottles and what have you. "John, you want to come to church Sunday?" "Pastor Baker, can I join your church?" I said, "Yeah, why not?" There was a young lady, his sister, was pregnant. She said, "You mean you'll take me?" "Yeah, why not? You're the very person we need in the church. You're what Jesus is all about. Jesus is calling you." Well, to make a long story short, folks, I had less trouble out of those people, welfare folks, folks who were poor, folks who the church looked down on, than I had those highly educated, middle class people. And I know we'll forget it. When John died, he probably died of alcohol, I don't know, but he came and called me to do a shoeage. They called me to do a shoeage. And I was glad to go. I had left the church about 5 or 6 years. I was glad to go and do his shoeage. People, it's folks like that who gives love to you. And Paul was humble. He didn't look down on anybody. And I'm going to tell you something. I learned this when I went to seminary at Moody Graduate School in Chicago. Professor, he was a Jewish professor named Dr. Benjamin. But also I give credit to B. Wayne Hopkins, my mentor. He said, "Wayne," said, "brother," said, "get enough education that you don't look down on anybody. And get enough that you don't have to look up to anybody." That helped me so much. I have never, ever looked down on anybody. I pastor 4 churches now, in any church that I pastor. People, it's not good to segregate yourself among a certain crowd. Now, everybody has favorites. You have people that you like to be around. But give the same amount of attention, the same amount of love to one as you do the other. Don't discern about it. We find that in 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, not discerning the body. That means not discriminating on the body. but everybody has access to cooperation. Everybody has access to the same joy. You don't put burdens on folks, but you treat them equal. So Paul is saying, fulfill ye my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. You see, Paul was a stickler on that, being of one accord, one mind in the Lord. Be like-minded. And if everybody would do that, people, we could get this gospel out to the world in probably one generation, if everybody was like-minded. But now it would take a little more time, since we're not like-minded. We're not up and at it, and we're not being sticklers to the gospel of like-mindedness, having the same love toward one another and being on one accord. Verse 3, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. What are you saying, Paul? I'm going to say that somebody else, I'm going to esteem that person better than me? Yes, that is exactly what you're saying. You see, in everything, there should be liberty in everything, including non-essentials. Look for every man on his own things. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Now, this is the incarnation. The Bible says, let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus. What mind is he talking about? The mind of Christ, the very essence of what Christ came to do. The mind of Christ should be in us at all times, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation. See, that's Jesus coming down. And took upon himself the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wow, what a savior. You mean Jesus left his home in heaven, came down as a servant to serve mankind, God serving human beings. He came in the likeness of sinful flesh, but he did not sin. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. Cardinal Wataya, better known as Pope John Paul II, in my opinion, the greatest pope ever to serve as pope in Rome, Catholic Church. He preached a sermon in his ordination sermon. He preached obedient unto death. People, that's what God is calling us to do. Be obedient unto death. Well, what did God do? God rewarded him by giving him a name above every name and highly exalting him. That at the name of Jesus, every knee, every tongue should bow to the glory of God, even things in heaven, in the earth, and under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Father God, I thank you for this message. I pray that it will be a blessing to someone who hear this gospel message. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now again, brothers and sisters, we thank you for writing us. You can write us at P.O. Box 12323, Columbus, Georgia, 31917. Or you can simply send your gift by PayPal or bring it by the church. We're here every day from 9 o'clock until 5. God bless you. But by all means, keep us in prayer. Pray for your church. Pray for the church as a whole. But be sure to pray for Spirit Field. And I pray that this pandemic will soon be over. I'm Pastor Wayne Baker from the Pastor's Corner, saying so long. And we will see you again next week. Until then, be assured that we are praying for you. God bless.
What can I say about Spirit Filled? Spirit Filled is a church that is definitely family oriented, and we believe in being together. When you're at Spirit Filled, you're at a place where you never ever feel alone. There's always someone either praying for you, checking on you, making sure you're good, and also spiritually feeding you. So we're thankful to have a pastor like Pastor Wayne D. Baker, who definitely teaches from the heart as well as from a place of education and higher learning. We're grateful to have that because he breaks down the word into a place in which you and I can understand and be able to add it to our practical lives every day. I'm telling you. So listen, if you now don't have a church home and you're looking for a place to settle and looking for a place to join and be a part of a family, please come see us at Spirit Filled Ministries, where it will be the end of your search for a friendly church.
Spirit Filled Ministries, the end of your search for a friendly church. We are located at 3898 Mulberry Drive, which intersects with Morris Road in Columbus, Georgia. Services begin at 10 a.m. on Sunday and Wednesday night Bible study at 7 p.m. You may also watch our services on YouTube and follow us on our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, hashtag FFMinistriesGA. You may also contact us by calling 706-562-0071 or via email at FFMinistriesGA@gmail.com. We hope to see you there.